zoning board of appeals meeting. My name is Howard Treister. This is Eric Stein, Wayne Baker board members. George Morris is from the planning board, and Sue Noyes is our administrative assistant. So, good evening.
Good evening.
So if you want to come up for, I guess we need to read this.
All righty, so.
I'll give my number back up.
Public hearing. Audrey Buckley, 12 Forest Street, Byfield. The applicant is requesting a special permit for relief from section 97-10D of the Woodbury zoning bylaws as the proposed detached accessory apartment requires a special permit for the lot property located at 12 Forest Street, Byfield, assessors map U13033.
Yes.
So, do you have paperwork?
I do. I'm all in check.
Okay, so we're ready for you to tell us what you'd like to do.
Sure. My parents, my aging parents, I'd like to build a detached handicap home. I'm on a property that's almost 3 acres, and my core property is over here, and it is less than 1,000 square feet, one level living, no stairs, with handicap access. I do have two separate rooms because my father hopefully is going to stop smoking. He's been in rehab for 3 months. But I did separate the building so he could have a private smoking porch. My mother has COPD, so we did do a two-bedroom unit. They haven't slept together for a while. But it's within all the restrictions, I believe. The Conservation Committee has approved it. They made me move it over a teeny bit. And so we moved it a little bit bigger, a little bit forward, but it actually made the property size smaller. So the one that said, the note that Sam wrote is probably 6 feet bigger than noted.
But when you say it makes the property size smaller, you're not developing a new lot.
No, no, no.
So really, it's not.
I just meant for the Conservation Committee. I shrugged it a little bit.
Okay.
I kept trying to say under 1,000, but Sam kept.
Right, yeah, yeah. So.
I have been working with Susan to make sure I got all the numbers right before I came.
Yeah, well, hopefully you do. Eric, you can move that over. So your existing house has a total of 2,119 square feet according to what you have here.
Yeah, including the home office.
Yeah, but that's part of the home, the structure.
So, well, the home office, in terms of the calculation, is part of the barn in the back.
Yes.
It's not part of the actual dwelling.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so that's kind of why.
Right, so what goes on in the barn in the back?
It's a garage and a wood shed. We did look at that initially for trying to convert that into a handicap home. And two architects and my engineer just said it would be a complete rebuild and not suitable for that. It was suitable for us to build a carriage house, but not for handicap. So we have.
But you didn't, you know, you have it listed here, but that's not, the 2119 is the actual house you live in.
The house I live in is actually smaller. So if you just detract the home office and I, in the rear, and what I thought I'd read, I didn't read correctly, what's that? That's okay. These three spaces are the actual house property.
Right.
The home office is a separate, is above the garage, but it's.
So if you take those three, then you add it up, it's 1802.
Yes.
Those three equal 1802.
I guess I, my math, your math, I'm the same. It looks to me like it's 21 something.
Sorry. 2170, sorry.
Right.
I did a separate.
Yeah, okay. So that's what we're interested in, not the home office.
Sure, okay.
Okay.
So if that is the case, I definitely do need a bit of a variance. And I did notice in your application that you do encourage a development of handicap spaces, looking for a variance for that.
I so what's on the application?
Yes.
Yes, it's on the application.
Yeah, that's true, the true application is the house.
Yeah.
Sorry. I need to submit it to Sam, I didn't know that.
And your septic, have you been to the Board of Health too?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah, that was, the deed has been, and then I dropped off the permit with us today.
So what did you come up with? For?
For, well, the size of the drawing, I came up with 18.02, just roughing it out at 16 scale, but it's kind of hard to measure off of this size.
Right, yeah.
Drawing. So, a couple hundred square feet, 2017, architected, did draw it, architected, put the numbers on it.
Right.
We did a reno when we first bought the house about 8 years ago.
No, I think where we're at is the technicality, do you understand what you want to do?
Yeah.
And I think for purpose and intent, if you've stated that clearly. But in terms of this particular request for a special permit, under bylaws, there's a pretty significant section of the bylaw that talks about accessory apartments in terms of purpose and intent. Talks about applicability, talks about general requirements, and then there are specific requirements for attached and then detached. And so in terms of reading the letter of the law, that's what I think we're going in terms of marching through step by step to make sure that you meet it.
Okay.
So we're not trying to pick it apart, we're trying to understand it, and we're trying to understand it as to the technicality of exactly what was written in the accessory apartments. And we've had quite a few of these in the past year, a couple of years ago, that necessitated going back and sort of editing the language to make it clearer, because it wasn't clear. People were submitting everything. So with that, the first part of the applicability is that it's either detached or is within, and obviously this is detached. The second part of that, if it's within, then you go to the building inspector and Sam can discuss it. If it's detached, Sam has to reject you and send you to us. The third part of that is that detached from an existing or new single-family dwelling may be authorized by the Zoning Board of Appeals, so that's why you're here with a special permit. And a property owner, you can certainly deny the may appeal the denial of a building permit for an accessory apartment within. Well, that doesn't apply to you because you're not within. So section three is general requirements. General requirements talk about the accessory apartment will be complete, separate dwelling unit that contains both a permanent kitchen, bathroom, and its own means of egress. So you have plans that I think prove out, A. B, the owner of record of residence, which the accessory apartment is created, must continue to occupy at least one of the dwelling units as their primary residence. So you're gonna continue to live on site, have it be your primary residence. Okay. C, for the purposes of the bylaw, the term owner shall mean one or more individuals residing in a dwelling unit who holds title, who hold title to the dwelling unit and the principal residence. D, the interior floor area of the primary dwelling, excluding unfinished attic and basement garage and porch, shall be at least 1,600 square feet. So even by my measurements, your house is at least 1,600 square feet. We say it's 2,170, it means that at 10. E, the gross interior floor area of the accessory apartment, excluding unfinished attic, basement, and porch, shall not be greater than 35% of the gross interior floor area of the primary dwelling as defined in 97-10D3D above, or 1,000 square feet. So you're obviously aware of the 1,000 square feet, and you've submitted the accessory apartment at 986 square feet. If we take 35% of 2,170, it's about 760 square feet. So there is a technicality there that we'll have to discuss. No more than one accessory apartment may be created on the lot. So obviously, if you're creating this, that's it. And the barn cannot be turned into anything else in the future. Then there should be no boarders or lodgers. You've identified who would be in the accessory apartment. So I think that's fairly clear there. H, the accessory apartment may not have more than two bedrooms. The total number of bedrooms in the primary dwelling and the accessory dwelling unit combined may not exceed the capacity of the permitted septic system per Title V. So in terms of H, my question there, Howie, is that the site has obviously an existing septic system.
Right.
The house and the barn are even connected to the same septic system. It's on the plan. And
yep.
A new septic system is being proposed for the secondary residence.
Okay.
So that, I think that will come into play.
I would just add that when we did the remodel, we went to septic for the main house, the barn has no running water or bathroom.
Right.
Okay. It's installed but not in use.
But the septic system was built just for your residence.
Before I bought it, they built it thinking they were going to do a hot tub and expand.
Well, I guess what we're getting in at is how many, has the Board of Health said that that's okay to go with the attached,
yes.
Detached?
Yes.
Okay.
And when John was there, he said that wouldn't suffice.
The Board of Health preferred to have the separate septic system.
Okay.
Which is why we did that. So this system stands alone on its own, and there was never intended to be any bedrooms back there or anything. So,
but I guess what we'll get back to,
we'll get there too,
is that the way, whether they prefer it or not, the way the bylaw states is this one septic system.
Yeah, the intent. The way the bylaw is written is that if you have a primary residence, you have a secondary residence. Secondary residence is subservient to the primary residence so that you're not creating a situation or a false situation in which the property looks like it has two totally separate dwelling units, in which if you drew a line down it, you could think you could sell half of your lot, but you haven't subdivided your lot, but you created it. And the last thing we want to do is give any approval for something that applies intent but actually isn't legal per the bylaws. And if you come back and say, well, the Zoning Board of Appeals approved it, we didn't approve it for that intent of having a subdivision that's a planning board issue and not our issue. And so it's something we need to discuss. And then one more shall comply with the applicable health, safety, building, and other applicable codes in effect at the time of the granting of the building permit and of the special permit where applicable. That will be true if Sam reviews it and gives you the building permit. The proposed accessory apartment shall not violate any deed restrictions applicable to the subject lot or residence. The applicant shall certify in a notarized statement to best of their, his or her knowledge that there are no such deed restrictions. Do you know of any? There's none that I could see on the plan. None of that you know of? Okay. Okay, utilities such as water, electric, gas, for the accessory dwelling unit shall be extensions from the existing utilities serving the principal family dwelling. So that's a key item in terms of making the accessory apartment subservient, because you're extending the electric lines run to your primary residence, and from your primary residence you then put a secondary meter and run from your house to the accessory apartment. And that is a safeguard to prevent against thinking that it is a total separate on its own, and it's easy enough just to say, I'll parcel that off.
Yes.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
You don't have the utility plan or anything that shows that, but
we do have the utility line showing here going, tying into the existing water line.
Okay.
And that's okay.
And what about the electric, and where is that coming from?
Not showing that. The current electric comes up along this property line up in here.
Right.
And that's totally up to the power company where they're gonna put it.
No. But it has to go from the primary residence to the accessory. You can't have a direct source of power to the accessory, the primary.
Yeah, you shouldn't be having, as much as you probably like it, you can't have them have their own water bill, their own electric bill, their own gas bill.
That's fine.
The bill goes to you, and you could sub-meter it to them, or you could just choose the portion, whatever your agreement is with them, but that unit needs to be tied back to your primary residence and not connected directly to the street.
Now, the question that I have may answer or may help to resolve any and all of these. There's not enough frontage on this for two lots. So in order for there to be two lots, we'd have to come back to the ZBA anyway.
The accessory apartments. Right.
So, then you would go through all this stuff again.
I know, but by granting items that are perceived as separate, then you sell the property and the next person comes in here and says, it's right off the street. We've got our own meter, we've got our own water, and they start making an argument based on something that we allowed, and it looks like a fish, it smells like a fish, and they're gonna argue and they're gonna get a lawyer that says, it is a separate thing. All the utilities are separate, all the meters are separate. It's got a separate septic system. That's not the intent of the accessory apartments in terms of having people starting to subdivide, or at least in the full appearance subdivide a lot that has everything but the title and grant, but physically it is. And that's why the bylaws are long and piece by piece are trying to do.
And I understand all of that, but here's a for instance, and you might be able to speak to this with planning board. When we do subdivisions and we show, because planning board regulations say, show the power, show the electric, show this, show that, guess what? The power company says, yeah, we're gonna put it where we feel like it. They don't care where it says on the plan. We're gonna put it where we think it's deemed best and where it's the safest to put it. So.
That's probably why I still have power lines all over my ground, because they do whatever they want to do.
This, one of the poles over here was being held up by a tree. So,
I know, but once
from
the pole, it goes to your meter. From your meter, it's your, you then have your own electric subcontractor do the work to get it to the accessory apartment. The utility might say that you need a new line from the street because you're gonna demand more power on the site, and so they may want to run from street to pole to meter. They may want to put a new meter on, and then from there it's a separate subcontractor doing the work. We're reading the text out of the bylaw, and George from the planning board wrote the bylaw can speak to the
So it should be able to connect.
Right, but I don't think.
We need to promise that tonight, or we need to have the power company promise it?
No. You need to understand that the power needs to come from your house.
It can't be a separate service.
I understand that.
So whatever the power company does or doesn't do, it's gonna go to your residence now, and then it has to go from there to, so it really makes, that's a new point where the power company's doing anything, okay? It says you can't go from the street to the accessory apartment. You gotta have a middleman.
It has to go from, if they, is it, ask me if I'm telling, reading this wrong, but if they wanted to use the same power line, drop the meter here, and have this line and that line both go off the same meter?
Yeah, well, where.
Is that okay?
Wherever your meter, well, it would go to your meter. You would then have, after your meter, you would have a subpanel.
Right, it's all off the same meter, it's all one service.
It goes to one meter, and after the meter is your electric line, not the utility's electric line.
Right.
So after that meter, however it's configured.
As long as it's one meter, one service, it could be two lines, but one service, one bill.
One bill, and then what you have is you have a secondary meter, and.
If you want to, but you're not gonna bill your parents, so.
No.
Right, so.
It'll just be one meter and two lines.
Right, and so that's.
And it did set up a brand new one closer to the house.
Whatever happens after the meter is the electrical subcontractor, and the contractor will do per building code what is required. But it will run from the house to there, and the water should run to your house and to there.
From your house.
And the gas should run to there. If you want cable directly there and have their separate cable, that's the cable company. But in terms of quote utility serving.
Have you read the same one?
Yeah.
Alright, so there's one more, a minimum of one parking space, if you require, it looks like you got more than enough space, so I'll stop there, you've got the garage. So then the next section is four, and it talks about accessory, attached accessory apartments, so we'll skip four. And then those that I just read, that whole page A through I, are the general requirements that need to be satisfied for either attached or detached. We're skipping the attached, and we're going to section five, which is detached. All detached accessory apartments shall meet the general requirements, which we just read through, set forth above, and the following special conditions. Special conditions A. A minimum lot size for accessory apartments and detached structures constructed after the adoption of this accessory bylaw apartment shall be 60,000 square feet. So I think you meet that by the size of the lot. Minimum lot size in existence as of the adoption date. So that, I don't think that does not apply. C, where accessory apartments are permitted in existing detached accessory structures, this isn't an existing detached structure, you're proposing a new one. And it just talks about shall be consistent with the appearance. Accessory structure shall be consistent with the appearance and purpose for which the structure was originally built. You're building a new one. If the accessory apartment is incorporated into a new accessory structure, the new structure shall be compatible in style and principle with the dwelling on the same lot. So you do something crazy. And it looks from your plans that you got a very beautiful, nice house design there. The proposed building scale should be consistent with the single family residence character of the lot and the surrounding neighborhood. So you've got a single level house, has porches, has dormers and stuff. A little bit of the design character, but it looks like it's, like I said, nicely designed. Accessory apartment. The abutting properties shall be protected from the proposed use and site by provisions of adequate buffer screenings against light, sight, and sound. So you have a tree line, you're not in the tree line, you're not pushing it up against 10 feet against the side lot line. I would think that it's, is there trees over in that area?
This is all wooded and then the power line is, the old power line is there.
Okay. And where's your neighbor over here?
The house is.
Yep.
There's a house.
About in here, but they're in the process of dividing that somehow.
They're trying to, yeah, sell off their lot.
And then back by you, is there?
Nothing, it's woods.
Okay.
It's all woods.
So he seems to be fine. Deviations and conditions of general requirements, the ZBA special granting authority may be allowed minor dimensional variations up to 5% of the minimum requirement for lot size and or maximum requirements for gross interior square footage for an accessory apartment, provided that in the board's opinion, the allowance of such variations is not contrary to the public interest and is consistent with the intent and purpose of this bylaw. B, under the deviations petitions, in order to encourage development of housing units for the disabled and handicapped individual persons with limited mobility, the ZBA has a special permit granting authority, may allow reasonable deviations from the stated conditions and requirements where necessary to install features that facilitate access and mobility for disabled persons, provided that the allowance of such deviations is not contrary to the public interest and is consistent with the intent and purpose of this bylaw. Section 7 is the submission requirements, site plans drawn to scale, shown boundaries, etc., etc., building floor plans, elevations drawn to scale, etc., etc., you've done all that. Drawings, if you were attached to section C, so drawing showing door locking configurations, just to make sure that you have a unit within a unit that you have proper arrangements for exiting and locking and security privacy. Section 8 is occupancy requirements. Approval of accessory dwelling units requires that the owner of record must occupy one of the dwelling units as if it were primary residence. We read that once before. Prior to issuance of a building permit, the owner shall send a notarized letter to the building commissioner stating that the owner will occupy one of the units. The building permit and special permit, where applicable, shall be recorded by the owner in the Southern Essex Registry of Deeds and Land Court. D, when the lot of the structure has received a permit for the accessory dwelling unit is sold to the new owner, he or she wishes to continue to exercise the permit, must, within 60 days of sale, submit a notarized letter to the building commissioner stating that he or she will occupy one of the dwelling units on the premise. So you are setting up your premise. You are encumbering your property with a special, an accessory apartment that has, you know, that needs to be known. You can't or shouldn't be selling your property with the intent that someone thinks that they have the idea that they have the right to subdivide it.
So that should, needs to be disclaimer.
Well, you should, or there's going to be trouble. And
no, we're not going anywhere.
I know. That's the intent.
Understood.
And part of what the couple issues we've got to get over are the safeguards that help safeguard against those perceptions.
Yeah.
So we want to talk about your job. Right. So, so you understand about the utilities now, that if this was to be approved, everything needs to run through the primary.
Yes.
Primary residence. Okay. And then.
That's required utilities. That's not optional. Utilities like cable, I think you mentioned.
Yeah, cable.
Optional.
Well, the cable's going to rip us off. We have cable in the barn, and we have to pay both.
Yeah. Yeah. Don't worry about. I don't think cables was part of the intent.
No.
You know, it's what you need.
I would love it. I would love all three to have one box.
Sure. I don't blame. So, the issue about the septic system. I know you said the Board of Health would prefer a secondary septic system, but if your primary system will accommodate that.
It will not. It will have
it
to
will
be
not.
Taken out and totally redone. And it's one of the reasons why she said, no, I would. Board of Health, and I don't know who supersedes who, CBA regulations or Board of Health? Board of Health,
well,
said she wants it separate.
It's different. That's all.
Yeah. But this would not accommodate.
Okay, so that won't.
That,
so.
That was
okay.
The premise. And that's what I wanted to do for the day.
A waiver or something?
And we were able to keep this septic system out of the buffer zone, where this septic system is in the buffer zone to the wetlands and would have to get expanded to be in that even more into the wetlands.
Okay.
So
I would think they would need a variance for that, George?
For that, yes.
And they might have a chance, I'm not saying you would, I'm just saying you might have a chance because of the wetlands.
Yeah, if the Board of Health says they want two.
Right.
And it's up to them what they want, can you override them possibly?
I'm not saying that we want to, I just want to make sure we do this the right way, you know?
And is it to the benefit to not override them, which is the wetland issue?
Right, right.
I'll speak with Doug about that, too.
So that's something we need to consider. Does that make sense to you?
I think that's a big issue.
Yeah, it is, it is. And so that's not gonna get solved tonight, okay? So the other thing is the accessory, this is under H, an accessory apartment may not have more than two bedrooms, you're okay on the two bedrooms, the total number of bedrooms, and, oh, I'm sorry, we just went over that. That was the septic system.
Yeah.
I'm going back to E, the gross interior floor area of the accessory apartment shall not be greater than 35%. You've gone over, gone over that. And it's very specific, the language that the planning board wrote, that we're only allowed 5%.
I understood the handicap was.
Well, that's something different. So you could, to make it, so you could go up, right now you're at 760 is what's required. You could go to 868 and.
Right, so you asked for 986, if you're allowed 5%, which is 40% of the 2,170, that's 868 square feet, it's 118 square feet difference.
So one question is, do you think you can shrink it 118 feet without, you need to talk to a builder or your architect or?
The difficulty is there's a handicap bathrooms and there's the two-way.
Okay.
And the two bedrooms.
All right, so there is a provision.
There is a living space.
There is a provision for handicap living.
Yes.
So, you know, that's something we can take into consideration. I'm glad you brought it up because it's not our job to do that.
Tell me what to do, anything to do. And that's it, you know, and I have talked extensively with Sam, trying to negotiate and understand and how to do this the right way.
So just to
Yes, sir.
Put this in perspective, if the house is 47.3 feet long and you took 2'6" out of the width of the house, that would be 118. So if you could make the argument in terms of accessibility on the stated width.
So you're saying make it smaller?
Well, I mean.
I have the argument that I can't, I have a different mother's an oxygen tank.
No.
That's 3 feet.
I'm just trying to put it in perspective of what 118 square feet of stated oversized is to these, to the technicality of the square footage of the top.
So.
I think the biggest argument is with the handicap and any wheelchair accessibility and that type of thing. I know my mother had Parkinson's, and so I didn't have a lot of parking in my house. I designed everything, and you have to have 36 inches clear all around whenever you're going anywhere in a room for wheelchair access.
Okay.
Your doors are all 36 inches. So like going into the kitchen that's on this plan, you have to have, if somebody's in a wheelchair, you have to be able to get to the sink with 36 inches all around. Same in the bathrooms. So
so I think in terms of what we've stated, what the intent of the bylaw is, and where we're going is we're looking for you to prove out and remove any issues. So if you could get a statement, or if you could add utility lines to that drawing, you could remove the issue of utilities. If you could,
yeah.
show the plan, I know you got the circle in the bathroom, but if you could show other circles and dimensions on a plan that prove out accessibility by code, it's not our job to make your argument. We would like to be as helpful as possible to you as residents, as we're all residents, and we understand what you're trying to do, but it's...
Basically what Eric's saying is come back to us and show us that we need 118 feet because of the handicapped accessibility. Okay?
Yeah, does that make sense? I think as we go, as we went through the entire section of the bylaw, it comes down to the two separate septic systems. It comes down to utilities directly off the primary unit, and it comes down to an argument for size, of which I think you have means in which to make an argument. I don't think we'll be sending you away and telling you to go try something only to come back and say no. So I think you have the ability to do it.
Okay. Oh, we'll see. We can make it smaller. Have talked to the architect or a portion.
Yeah, well, first talk to the architect and show us that you need, I know you're saying what handicap needs.
Just prove that out.
Just prove it out.
There is a handicap marker on the bottom.
Right, there is. So if you can prove to us, which I think you can, other than you just saying that, you need 36 inches and all that, your architect or an engineer, someone that deals with that,
right,
and gives us something concrete.
He can write a narrative, and he can certainly put some dimensions on this plan.
Absolutely, brought up. By the way, the reason she's upset is only because she was hoping to be able to get this started.
Well, I'm
because
sure.
Of what her parents are going through right now and stuff. So it's nothing with you guys.
But you have to understand that we need to.
You need to do due diligence.
If we want you to do this for the letter of the law, so that there is no issue or no challenge.
Sorry,
no, that's fine. That's fine.
And there are no issues later. And I think that is one of the hardest parts is trying to grant special permits, but also not to give anybody any false, my whole statement.
And understandable.
But you know what I'm saying?
I understand. All right.
Okay. So, as far as the septic system, go to the Board of Health, get a statement from them for us. And if you need to, go see Doug, Conservation, showing that it would be a hardship to expand that.
Because of its location.
Because you need to have a hardship.
Yep.
Of the land for a variance. So that's how you prove.
I'm sure Doug would be thrilled not to.
Yeah, so you have to, he knows all about this, so you just have to prove it to us that there's a hardship.
Now, does this all still fall into the special permit, or is there anything that kicks it into a variance?
I think you don't have to reapply.
Again, I'm going letter of law here,
yeah,
but we don't do it right. Then.
I know the Conservation, they just had me come back and bring all the stuff they wanted to see.
Yeah, I don't think you have to reapply, but...
I think, I don't know, but I think if they're able to prove those items out, you have the ZBA regulations to
Right. Back
give that authority.